We'll get going with our afternoon presentations. First, I'd like to introduce someone that's going to assist with some of the model and demonstration this afternoon. You got to watch her putt earlier with a beautiful putting stroke. Wait till you see her golf swing. Miss Veronica Felibert grew up in Caracas, Venezuela. She's a multiple-time Venezuelan national champion as an amateur and represented Venezuela in the World Amateur Championships. She earned a scholarship and played collegiate golf at USC, where she won at the collegiate level. From there, she went on to play the Epson and LPGA tours. Arguably one of the most beautiful swings in golf. She obviously does an amazing job taking care of her body and tuning up the machine so it can perform at its best. She's currently the fitness director here at Virginia Country Club, Miss Veronica Felibert. And then our presenter, Mr. Dave Phillips, is a longtime member of the PGA, a past Teacher of the Year and Horton Smith Award winner. I feel like I say this for everybody that's speaking. He's a top 100 on the Golf Magazine, has been for over 20 years, top 50 in your Golf Digest list. He is the co-founder of the Titleist Performance Institute, which was established in 2004. At the time, the goal was to create a real golf performance facility that looked at every aspect of the game, from biomechanics to swing, equipment fitting, nutrition, fitness, and overall wellness. From that time to now, TPI has now over 24,000 certified experts in 64 countries. So they're catching up to us PGA members. It's pretty unbelievable. And I got to do TPI certification in 2008, so I don't know, Dave will have to tell us how early on that was in the process, but Jamie was a big part of allowing me to go do that and saw the value in what they were doing down there from a very early perspective. Dave has made numerous appearances on the Golf Channel. He's a contributor to Golf Magazine, Golf Digest, Sports Illustrated, and Men's Health. Among his current students is John Rahm, who's held the number one world amateur golf ranking and, of course, the number one official world golf ranking. He's also the 2021 U.S. Open champion. In addition to Rahm, Dave has helped numerous PGA and LPGA professionals, candidly, way too many to list, and it's likely well into the hundreds. So please welcome Mr. Dave Phillips.
All right. Thank you very much. I was going to come up here and do a backflip, but I had too much for lunch. So, all right. So this is great. It's always great to be with people that I love to be around. Golf professionals, medical, fitness. You guys know we do a lot of this kind of thing, a lot of presentations. And I know it's hot, so my goal is to keep you moving a little bit. If you ate a lot for lunch, it might be kind of difficult to do the 40-yard sprints we're going to do. No, just joking. Okay. All right. That's better. All right, so now I can really, really thank him, right? So obviously, Jamie does so much for us as PGA golf professionals. I've seen how he handles his players on tour. I've been around him quite a bit. Unfortunately, I was on the losing Ryder Cup team with Steve, so we're gonna get you in Italy. You're gonna buy us pizza over there. But basically, you know, he's definitely one of my mentors, somebody I look up to, as many of you are here. There's a lot of people here, Sean Cox, there's Kip Puttabar, there's different coaches here that I've known for a long time. I've loved what you do. I watch what you do. I'm a student of the game. Really, all we are is custodians of the game, right? We learn information and we pass it on, and that's our job. And hopefully we make it a little bit better than it was before. And that's really the job of an elite level coach. So today, I've got really three things that I want to talk to you about. We'll keep this pretty simple. I want to talk to you about my philosophy for coaching. I want to talk to you about TPI, what we do, what you think we may do, and what we actually do, right? Because it might be different than what your thought process is. And I want to talk to you about injury-inducing mechanics, some things that we may be teaching that you don't know could potentially take that person out of golf, right? And that's very important for us as PGA members. We've got this incredible opportunity over the last couple of years to see an explosion in our game because of a pandemic. The COVID crisis changed the playing fields. It got people outside. It was the only thing they could do. We need to keep them in the game. And the other thing, in order to keep this game good for all of us, you need to understand this, the body. And I'm gonna get passionate about this because this is what I do, right? And I've seen too many people go down this track. They buy the best technology, they buy the best equipment, They're teaching force and pressure, 3D, whatever it is. They're looking on their phone every day at some new swing style, mechanic, whatever. If you don't look at this, and this doesn't just include fitness, it includes this as well, you're missing a huge piece of the puzzle. And the only reason we don't is we're not educated yet. But there are a lot of good people. The NeuroPeak people are here. You got an incredible presenter after me that is Cam Smith's performance coach. I've listened to everything. He's amazing, right? That's this connection between the brain and the body. So not only the body swing connection, but it's now the body brain swing connection. Because I've done a lot of traveling around the world, as many of you know. Part of my job is to educate myself. I spent some time with Formula One and the Formula One teams. They've got an incredible facility in Virago, Italy, where they actually have a mental acuity training gym. I was like, what is that, right? And they're like, well, if you're training your skill and you're training your body, but you're not training your brain to take those two things and maximize it, you'll never use those to the potential that you can, right? So understanding this new body of work that's coming out, the neuroscience space, should be part of our core principles as golf instructors. So, you know, I always tell stories. He knows I'm a big storyteller. And I'm driving up here today. I've got this Bronco. Have you seen these things? So I ordered it 2 years ago and it came in. I was like, I didn't even know I ordered a car. And then I told my wife that I had to buy this car. So I've got this Bronco. And I'm driving on the highway up here from TPI. And this song starts playing. And I think I have my phone here. I think I've got it because I'd love you to hear this. I think I had it on Spotify. I'm gonna play you the verse, the chorus of this song. All right, so here we go. Let me crank up the volume. I just want you to listen to it. Doesn't really mean anything at the time, but it did when I was driving. Listen, come on right now. How you want to see yourself today? That is huge in my coaching, right? I'm driving along, and this guy pulls up behind me, and he's got one of those chopper motorcycles, right? He's got the old helmet from the 70s. The forks go way out like this. The hair is coming out the back. I only wish I had hair like that. And he comes flying up behind me. And I'm looking in the mirror, and I hear this song, and it's saying, how do you want to see yourself today? And I'm thinking, that guy sees himself as fearless, and he's zipping in and out of the traffic, right? And I'm like, that is such a big part of my coaching, because I'm a big believer, if you can't see it, you can't be it, right? So when you've got students, you need to sit down and really find out where they're trying to go. So that's number one. You've got to figure out, are you trying to be the next PGA Tour player? Are you trying to be Patrick Cantlay, John Rahm? Or you just want to play a little bit more golf? Do you want to be a junior player that gets a college golf scholarship and takes it to the next level? How do you want to see yourself today? And where do you want to go? Those are big foundations of what I do. Because what I do is I take that and then I figure out how to build a team around that athlete to help them get there. Now that team could just be me at the start. Maybe they're a beginning golfer and they just need some skill, right? But maybe they want to get to the next level. And to get to the next level, we have to have this understanding of what are the pieces to the puzzle there are. Because there's a big difference, as my friend Mark Blackburn said this morning, between teaching and coaching. When we first start, we're teachers. We start learning instruction. Most of us don't know what we're doing. We just tell everybody what we do, right? And then we evolve and we go different. And then when you get to a certain stage in life, when you're older, like us two, you start to realize that it's simplicity. I watch Butch Harmon teach all the time, and he'll stand there and he'll walk around and he'll say one thing and the guy hits it perfect. And everybody's like, Butch doesn't really know anything. He doesn't know TrackMan and all this stuff. I'm like, no, he knows a lot, because he just looked at everything and turned around and said one thing and the guy hit it better, right? And that's the art of coaching. That's how you get to that next level. But to understand that, you have to look at this. So one of the things we're gonna do is I'm gonna take you on this journey into TPI. Veronica's gonna help me. She's gonna hit a few balls. I'm gonna run a couple physical screens. She looks like she's in incredible shape, so she probably passed everything, right? But she might not. And I'm gonna run a few things. I might have you guys stand up for a minute and try a few things, and we'll have a little bit of fun. This is the Tree of Trust, so Don't panic if you can't do it. It's okay. But you've been sitting a while, and I don't like you to sit. I like you to move. You can see I've got passion and energy, and that's kind of what we're going to do today. Okay, so let me start you down this track of kind of TPI. So TPI was developed by myself and a chiropractor, Dr. Greg Rose, back in 2000. The nucleus of it happened around 2000. And it was driven by, I was a golf instructor at the time. In 1998, I was nominated as the first, actually, the youngest top 100 teacher. I was 32 years old. I had this incredible teaching center at Caves Valley Golf Club, where his guy won, with beautiful learning center. It was one of the first big learning centers at the time. And excuse my French, but I thought I was the it, right? And I get this thing in the mail saying, you are a top 100 teacher, and I panicked. And the reason I panicked, that I was like, there are people on that list that are my mentors that aren't, there are people that are not on that list that are my mentors, that I go to for advice. How did I get on this? And at the time, I didn't understand their selection process. I was teaching Tom Kite and Hal Sutton and a bunch of different guys. I had this incredible learning center. And I said, I need to be better at what I do. And if you wind back the clock a little bit further, my introduction to golf was, I grew up all over the world, right? I was born in England, raised in Kenya. And I've lived in 27 different countries, and my dad was in the military. I had a crazy childhood growing up. I came to America from Botswana with $37 in a suitcase and an old broken set of Spalding Top Flight irons. Don't tell Titleist I said that. And I remember getting dropped off at the airport. I got a college scholarship to play college golf for a small school in Florida that I had no idea what it was. It was just the only way for me to get out of Florida. It was called Eckerd College. It was this little school, and they had an international business program, so I figured that's what I would do. And I got here to America, and I got involved with college golf. And I grew up in Africa. We had no golf balls to hit. We didn't have driving ranges like this. We basically figured it out. And I used to just watch good players and copy them. And I got pretty proficient at it. And I got there, and all of a sudden, I get in this coaching environment where they're taking a video camera out, and they're filming my swing, and they're comparing me, and they're saying, you need to do this, this, this. And the more I did it, the worse I got. I lost my ability to play the game. I was so concerned with how I moved the club. I didn't know how to move the club correctly. I was just told, you're doing this, and you need to do that. And it took me on this journey that I ended up not playing very good. And even though I tried to compete, I never quite made it. But part of my passion, because I love the game so much, was I'm gonna figure that out. And I didn't figure it out until I met Dr. Greg Rose. So I had gotten this path of learning, and I'd worked for David Ledbetter, and I'd worked for a bunch of different guys, and I went to Mac, and I went to a lot of great instructors. I went to Jim McLean, I went to Butch, I went to Mac, I went to Jim Hardy, I went to a lot of great coaches. And what I noticed along the way is they were all good. They were great communicators. That was number one. The second thing I noticed is they all had different styles of coaching, which is fine. We all have different styles. It's okay to disagree. The only reason, though, that you don't agree is usually because you're either threatened by them or you're uneducated. So you got to educate yourself. So there's a great bridge that crosses into New York called the Walt Whitman Bridge. And on the side of the bridge, it basically says, don't be judgmental, be curious, right? And that is what I've always lived by, is that I don't judge anybody, any of you, about what you teach. If it conflicts against something I do, I'm curious. Why do you do it that way? Why is it that you think that way? Because if you can convince me and you can educate me, I'm in. If you can't, I'm out. I'm judgmental. No, but that's basically what I do, right? So along the way, I worked for all these great teachers, as we all do, and we all read books and stuff. That's why you're here. And then about 2001, I'm at my teaching studio in Caves Valley, and it's pouring with rain. And there's an article in the Washington Post about this guy, Dr. Greg Rose, in Washington, D.C., and he is coaching the World Long Drive Tour, Jason Zuback, and he's doing biomechanics and fitness evaluations. And I'm like, never heard of that before. Never heard of it. So what is this? So I pick up the phone, call him. He says, why don't you come down and see what I do. It's raining today. I've got a couple cancellations. And I was like, I'm in. And he goes, and by the way, if you have a player, bring him down. So I get this young kid. I'm like, we're going. We jump in the car. We drive down to Washington, D.C. Meet Greg at the door. Opens the door. We go into this gym. And then he's got this basement. And he's got hitting bays and chipping areas and nets. And he's like, I'll tell you what. Before you say anything, let me show you what I do. I'm in. Let me see it. He takes the student, brings him up in front of me, takes him through a movement screen. Takes about 6 minutes. He's writing down on this piece of paper. He turns around to me and he goes, that's what they're going to do in their golf swing. And if you try and do anything else, they're going to struggle. I look at this piece of paper and everything that I battled with the student was on that piece of paper. And I looked at him and I'm like, how did you do that? And he said, it's very simple. He said, I understand the golf swing. He goes, and I understand the human body. And if you're trying to get somebody to turn into their hip and push into the ground and get their arms up here, and they can't physically do it, they will struggle. And right then and there, the light went on. Because I was like, this is why so many great coaches have players that succeed, because they can physically do what you're asking them to do, and others that fail because they trust you, they're trying their hardest, but they can't physically do what you're asking them to do. And that's with the nucleus of starting TPI. So I went to Titleist, I convinced the CEO, Wally Uline, to come down. I remember driving him back to the airport. He said, that's the future of golf instruction. Get with Greg, figure out what you two want to do, and I'll help fund it. And I was like, unbelievable. And when we did it, we built TPI, which is here in Southern California. We're going through a $15 million renovation right now. We built that in 2003. We're bulldozing the whole place. We're starting all over again because the technology has changed, and we always want to be on the cutting edge. So he gave us the keys to build the first Olympic training center for golf. Look at things that other people aren't looking at. So that's why I'm the custodian. I'm the guy that's looking out for you. So even though we have the certification program and we do it all over the world, and we have 28,000 people in 64 countries and we educate in 10 different languages, I'm flying around looking for things that we're not doing. And there's a lot of things we're not doing. And as an organization, we need to be better because we have these people that love this game and are coming into this game. And it's on us if we do a bad job. If you hurt somebody because you're teaching them and they can't do what you're asking them to do, that's on you. And I see it because all the injuries come to us. The bad backs, the broken backs, the torn shoulders, the guys on tour that can't play anymore. You know, they come to us. Once they finish trying to figure it out, we get a knock on the door, can you help me? And then it's our job to try and put them back together. But it didn't need to happen. It happened because there's so many things we do in a golf swing that can cause injury. But if your body's functional, a golf swing doesn't cause injury. Dysfunctional body with a golf swing causes injury. So take this right now, because this is very simple. The body, it works in an alternating pattern of stable segments connected to mobile joints. Stable segments connected to mobile joints. When you're born, you have a shoe, you have a foot, sorry, that has an arch in it. Some of us have high arches, some of us have low arches or flat arches. If you're that guy that gets out of the pool and there's three little dots, you got high arches. If you're the guy that gets out of the pool and there's a whole footprint, your arches have dropped, you got flat feet. The foot should be stable, that's why we have an arch in it. If you lose stability in the foot, the next joint gets affected. The ankle should be mobile. It moves really good in three planes, okay? The knee should be stable. Our knee is really good at doing this. It doesn't really like to go sideways very much. It can, but it doesn't. Our hip should be mobile. We should be able to move our hip in every plane of motion. Our lower back should be stable. That's why we want core strength. Our thoracic spine should be mobile. Our shoulder joint should be stable. We don't want that moving all over the place. So the body works in an alternating pattern of stable segments connected to mobile joints. So when something happens to one of those, whether it's you go for a run or you injure yourself, most people injure themselves doing their hobby on the weekend, not at work. When you blow a knee or you hurt an ankle and you think it's repaired, you have scar tissue. Your brain knows there's a problem. Now you got a problem up here. Because now your brain is going, well, I know it feels better, but it really hurt. I don't want to go there. It's like all the stuff we're doing now for speed. You can only go as fast as this will let you go, right? And if there's something along that chain that's broken, You can't go that fast. There's people that do these speed sets and training all the time. We do it. We train long drive guys. And they get tremendous speed increases. And then there's others that don't. Or they can't take it to the golf course. That's usually this problem. You don't know what to turn on to get it to go. Or there's something stopping it. So think of the body as this alternating pattern. That's not hard. I'm not a movement expert. My body is. I'm a golf professional like you, and I can do the screen. The screen is for me. It's not for the student. It's for me. So I should be able to take somebody very quickly and say, hey, come on up here for a second, do a couple of these things, and let me see your movement pattern, right? That's what we do at the very beginning of TPI. Now, TPI has evolved. We've been doing this a long time. And now we're at a stage where we work with 16 Major League Baseball teams. We work with tennis players. We work with soccer players, all kinds of athletes. Because the progression is rotary movement, ballistic using the ground. I want to look at basketball players' vertical jump and how they do it. I want to watch it, the best pitches in the world. So we have it all. They come to TPI and they love it. They're like kids. They don't want to go to a baseball place. They want to come to us. And we put them on biomechanics and we do the movement screens and we build programs for lots of athletes. So when people talk about the how, what, and the why, you've probably read this book by Simon Sinek. It's an amazing book. If you don't have it, you need to read that book, Simon Sinek. And it basically talks about what is your why. People don't buy what you do, they buy why you do it, right? At TPI, the what? What is the what? The what is video camera, 3D. I need to look at your golf swing and find out what you're doing. What are you doing right now, right? Then I want to know how you're doing it. That's force and pressure. That shows me how you're interacting in the ground to create that rotation or the reason why you're flipping. The physical screen is the why. That's why you do it that way. It's that simple. That's the how, what, why, right? And it's that easy. So a lot of us get into this world of, I gotta have the latest thing, I gotta have force and pressure, I gotta have the latest 3D system. That's great, unless you don't know how to use it, then it's more dangerous than it is helpful. So make sure you know how to use it. And then the second thing is when I buy technology, someone that's selling it has a software program. Here's how you use it. I'm not interested in how they use it. I'm interested in what I can do with it to teach me something new. So a lot of times I have to either rewrite their software. So for instance, force and pressure plates. We know it's a big movement today that you can increase speed. Force precedes movement. If I'm trying to get my arms down faster, where are you pushing? When are you pushing? One of the big things we've learned is that most of us give instruction that is way too late. Because if you're thinking about pushing at the top of your backswing, it's over, right? That's why when you see these guys that have got movement like this, they're loading the ground. The club hasn't even gone anywhere yet. Most players, by the time the club starts moving, they're already going the other direction. So your instruction has to be that much faster than it is now. You have 1.2 seconds for a good player to move that golf club. 1.2. Average amateur, maybe 1.5. Really high speed, long drive guy, maybe one, maybe less, the speed they're moving. What are they going to think about in a second if you got all these swing thoughts? You can't do it. So you need a functional body that can move the way you want it to move. And then you got to base your instruction and your information about when to push, how to push, what direction to push. Very, very important. When. That's a big, big factor. Okay? Don't ever forget that. So, am I going too fast? Am I doing all right? Okay. Because I can get going. And you'll see. Because I love this. I'm so passionate about this because I see the errors. Okay, you give me a couple of that. Give me that. If I need to pace it down, I'll pace it down. Okay. All right, take it up a notch. Okay. Wind it up. And there'll be plenty of time for questions because I know this always, people get intrigued by this and they're like, is this guy just crazy or what's going on? But I am a little cray-cray. Who's not? And we'll get into like John Rahm, guys like that, and some of the players. I mean, everybody wants to know what the best players do. And we're going to check out Veronica because she's awesome. And I've already looked at a couple things, but I want to show you a couple things with her. And we'll do that in a minute. So let's look at guys like the elite. Because really, when you leave here, I want you to go back to tomorrow and at least learn like three things. What do the best do? What is the 60-year-old doing? What is the guy that's 30 that wants to get better? And what are our juniors doing? What are we doing with them, right? That's what you need to know. So at the elite, you get a guy like John Rahm. Jon Rahm gets screened every Monday on the PGA Tour. Every Monday morning, or Tuesday, depending if it's a travel day, I have medical professionals out there. John, come here. Get over here. Put your arms across your chest. Can you separate your lower body from your upper body? Can you keep your lower body still? Can you move this? Let me see your ankle mobility. Every Monday. That information allows me then as his coach to give him the directive of what we're doing this week. Because if the movement's not great, do you think I want to go and have him hit balls? I don't want to do that. Because inevitably, he's going to go out there and he's going to hit some shot. Not that he hits a lot of bad shots because he's pretty good. But he's going to hit some shot that he doesn't like. And he's going to think he's got a swing problem. But it's just a movement problem. On the elite level, Rick knows, you know, these guys are traveling week in, week out. They're on planes. They're in different beds. They have different tea times. They eat different food. They're going through different time zones. This is different every week. I'm just trying to figure out when is it and what do I need to put back so that he can do what he does. And then I get out of the way. Let him do what he does. He doesn't need another swing tip from me or another lesson from me. Are there things we're always working on? Yes. Are there things that I think can make him even better? Yes. But that's not my job. My job is to manage the team and take this horse that's pretty damn good and make sure it can run every weekend. And that's what I'm trying to do, right? So that's at that elite level. If you start to parse that down to the next level, you might say, okay, well, the mini tours, they can't afford a fitness trainer and a medical guy and a nutritionist and this guy. But we can educate them on what they should do. We can give them an exercise protocol, pre-round warm-up, post-round cool-down. We can make sure they're getting enough rest and sleep. We've got things like the Aura Ring, the Whoop Band, NeuroPeak. We got all of these different devices today. Those are recovery. So at the elite level, what we're most focused on today is recovery. How can I get them back to where they used to be? How can I get them to shut it down? Because there is so much going on. Not just on the golf course. You should see what they got to deal with off the golf course, right? They got cameras. They got TV. You got to need you over here. You got to sign autographs. You got to do this. You got to do that. Then I need you over here to talk to these people that are sponsoring the event. Then I need you over here. It's not as easy as everybody thinks it is. At the elite level, these guys are really good. And to get to that level, the other big thing is I'm a big believer that I think things like ADD, ADHD, that in this country, for some reason, we think is a problem, is a benefit. That's their superpower. People that are like that can hyper-focus for a small amount of time. What do you need to be able to do in golf? Hyper-focus for like 1.2 seconds and then get rid of it. Let's go. And most of the top players, the top performers in the world, and you can look at them, they've got a flickering light going on up there. There's something that makes them them, right? Go and look at the guys that are always top 10 in the world. You're like, that guy's a little strange. What he's doing over there? What is going on? He looks at me with those black eyes like a shark. There's something going on. I think that's a superpower. I think that's what makes them them. And you can look at any sport and you will find that. Because those are the type of people that can hyper-focus, and to be that focused is selfish, right? Because they've got to put family aside. They've got to be able to do that. And if they can't do that, which means everything to all of us, but how are they able to do that? Some of these guys go 3 weeks in a row on the road. They don't see their kids. They don't see their wives. They have to get on a plane again. They have to do all that. And that's that level, right? If we take this down to the country club level, look at this place. Is this amazing or what? Look at what we have here. This is incredible. And if you got that little piece of dirt at your place and you don't have this, let's start rethinking about what you could do. Because that gym takes up no space at all, and they got everything I would ever need. I probably don't even need all of that to get you in really good shape, right? But don't try and do it yourself as a golf professional. Get an expert. Get somebody that knows, that buys into your philosophy, that buys into your coaching, and work with them. Make them part of your team. I can't stand going to country clubs and, oh, yeah, we got a gym. It's over there. But I don't talk to those guys because they show up in Lululemon every day. And I got to wear this, right? That's crazy. You're leaving business on the table. You should be interacting and working together. Three-hour sessions. Come out here. Show them a movement. Get them going. That's what you should be doing. So at the country club level, amazing. And even physical therapy. Physical therapy. You have a physical therapist right here on staff. right? Physical therapy, that should be part of a club. You know how many of you can't move? Let me show you. All right. Should I get you up? All right, stand up. Yes. Remember, this is the tree of trust now. This is a tree of trust. All right, everybody stand up. Stand up, stand up. Okay, first one. I want you to cross your arms, cross your chest like this. Side on. Imagine your belt is a bucket of water. I want you to pour the water out of the bucket, and I want you to stop the water pouring out of the bucket. Can you do that? We're not back in college here. Come on. Arch your back, flatten your back. Arch your back, flatten your back. Arch your back, flatten your back. Is there anybody frozen? Come on, tree of trust. Anybody like, what the heck? Are you frozen? Can you? Your back's already, well, that, if you have a pre-existing injury, that's one thing, okay? So it shakes one way. So that's called shake and bake. Ricky Bobby, baby, shake and bake. You got a little shake and bake. So that's perturbation. That's the abs not quite connecting. So while you're standing, let's do a couple more. So arms crossed. Here's another one. Can you keep your shoulders perfectly still and separate your lower body from your upper body? Rotary. Rotary. Do you mind if I use you real quick? Come on up here. Okay, Veronica, come over here. This is a fair comparison. Come on. All right, all right, all right, here we go. We're going to show you our better side. We're going to turn and show my butt. All right, watch this. Okay, turn and show me your butt. All right, we're going to go together here, right? Arms crossed. We're just going to keep our shoulders perfectly still, and we're going to rotate. Okay? Pretty good, right? What is he doing? That's like wagging the dog tail, right? You're trying. You're doing a great job. But you're going side to side. You're this guy, right? You're like, I wish I was on the beach with a Mai Tai doing some hula. You need rotation. You're going a little side to side. So there's a little bit of a problem. So the next one, which you can all try, keep this perfectly still. And this time, just rotate your upper body. But don't move your lower body. I don't want to see a belt moving. I don't want to see a belt moving. Okay, again, he's a little bit this way and this way. So everything on his pattern already is a little bit side to side, right? Okay, sit down, sit down. Thank you so much. So we just did three screens, and I took my time, right? We just did three screens. I just took my time. So here's what they could show me. If you're this guy, right? If you're this guy, I could get sway, which when you rotate, I could get some reverse to my spine. I could get slide, little excessive side bend, because you can't rotate. This one, the pelvic tilt, one of the most important ones you can have, right? Most people look at it and go, that's kind of weird. I don't know if I want to do that. That's what the best players in the world do. And here's where they do it. When you set up to the golf ball, your hips, depending on the club, are tilted forward, anywhere from 20 to 30 degrees, depending on the length of the club, right? So I got a little bit of hip hinge. As I go back, the right hip goes up and behind me, and I'm going to increase that tilt. So I've got water pouring out of the bucket. I tilt forward, there's a little water pouring out of the bucket. As the right hip goes up and back, a little more water is going to fall out of the bucket. But here's what happens in transition. As I shift, because I'm pushing properly, my belt will tuck. We call it, everybody's like, look at the jump, look at the vertical jump. My belt will tuck and allow me to rotate. If you can't do that, you can't stay in posture during your golf swing. You will early extend, which I've talked about many times. In fact, in the magazine you guys get, there's an article that I talk about, which is my pet peeve, early extension. And the reason it's my pet peeve is it affects good players like you. In fact, on the PGA Tour, if I look at the best in the world, I'm talking the top 10, they don't early extend. We go beyond the top 10, there's a few that early extend. Now, I'm not saying that the best players in the world move perfectly, because they don't. I can show you a lot of people that don't move that well. Those are the ones I'm more interested in, because I'm like, you got to the PGA Tour and you move like that? Think about how much better you might be able to get if we clean this up, or maybe not. This is where you have to be careful and you have to have a plan. And this is what I always look at, is I'm looking at motion and movement, because I know that this is the connection. So when I look at players and I look at the average country club golfer, they do a lot of what you're doing right now. They sit. They've got a job. They drive to work. Here in LA, they may be in the car for 4 or 5 hours. They're on a train, they're on a plane, they go to the office, they sit down, they get on a computer, they get on Zoom. That's their job. So what's the one thing they don't use? They don't use their glutes. It's the biggest muscle in your body, the glute. It is the anchor of the golf swing. It enables me to do so much. But if it isn't working, what are you going to use? You're going to use your hamstrings. You're going to use your lower back. You're going to use above and below. If this doesn't work, oh, screw it. Dave wants me to turn more. I'll just use this. Damn him. All right? And off you go. So just sitting in your chair, a little glute test you can do while you're sitting there. This always looks great on camera. I want you to lift yourself off the seat with your right glute, inflate it, and then do the left glute. Look at you, you're all like, firing your glute. Fire the glute one way, fire the glute the other way, right? You got it? Anybody fire one, but they couldn't fire the other one? You did? We call you a half ass. Okay. It's okay. So basically, glutes are the power source, right? Am I trying to tell my players when they set up to the golf ball that they have to activate their glutes? No, I should have done that in the gym. But there are things that you can do that are very simple. Every 20 minutes, stand up, do a little bit of these, kind of just get your calves going. That'll fire your glute. Stand here, dig your big toes into the ground. It'll fire the glute. Those are little things that activate the glute and keep it going. These are little things that I want to bring back with my amateur golfers. So when we build an exercise program, do I want strength? Do I need mobility? Do I need power? Well, that depends. It depends on my student. Depends on where they're trying to go. Because ideally, I'm into longevity. I don't know about you. I want to live as long as I can. But more importantly, I want to perform for as long as I can. So I want to live till I'm wherever, say 80. But I want to be active till I'm 80, like we all do. The number one reason people go downhill is because of movement issues, right? Movement should be a vital sign. You don't know if you have a heart problem or high cholesterol unless you go to a doctor and he checks you out and he does an EKG and he gets your blood work. But if I ask you to get out of that chair and you can't get up, you know. If I ask you to go for a run and your knee hurts, you know. Movement should be a vital sign. And we need to be better at integrating it, because if we do, we could keep playing this game for a long, long time. The number one power loss in golf, right over there, the golf cart. Great. Let's sit on a golf cart, turn off our glutes, drive to the ball, jump out, and expect to hit it 300 yards. Walking, one of the best ways to keep your glutes firing, right? You can see this on the senior tour. It's great. You just watch the data. I mean, I've watched the data. Get to the senior tour, everything's good. Walking out there, 3 rounds, no cut. This is great. I'm still hitting it, Padraig Harrington, with my penguin feet. I'm going to go out there, and I'm going to hit it 350 yards, and he's great. And I love Padraig. And he walks. John's over there with a cart with, I don't know what's in his glass. That looks like fun. I'm going to go over there. And they jump in the golf cart and they start getting a golf cart. And all of a sudden, they're doing that same thing. They rush up to their golf ball, they jump out, and they expect to hit great shots in their glutes. So if you're one of those people that you start to lose your butt, and for some reason it's gone either into your thighs or it's come out here, bring back your butt. That's the best thing you can do for life, for longevity, for your golf swing. Bring back your butt, okay? All right. Let's have Veronica hit some balls. Let's take a little look at her, and let's just see kind of how she moves and what she does, because she's awesome. She has a great swing, and I got to watch her hit a few. And again, this is always not easy, right? It's got all, I mean, think about this. You got all these golf pros watching you hit balls. So she hasn't hit any. She's going to hit a couple chip shots, pitch shots, and then just let her warm up. And then I'm going to ask her, because she looks like she hits it great, I'm just going to ask her a couple questions. I'm going to do what I do, right? So whenever you got a player, the number one thing you always want to do is make the environment comfortable. Make them, it's hard to do with, hey, by the way, come and hit some balls for me, and I got 300 pros. They're going to watch you. Comfortable? Not exactly, right? You want to make them comfortable, but this actually would be a good stress test. This would be a good heart rate variability test. So everybody's got Whoop and stuff like that. With John, I use the Fitbit, $90, but it shows his heart rate. So I can actually work on getting his heart rate up and down without opening my phone, looking at the data. I just want to look at heart rate. I want to see, can I get it up? Can I get it down? So let's just have Veronica hit a few short shots, and then I'll talk to her a little bit. And you can just watch what we do. Any injuries I should know about? Nothing? You're just the perfect specimen, aren't you? Damn it. It just happened. Jamie's like, I got something you can use. I'm like, she's perfect. All right, here we go. She's just gonna warm up, hit a few shots. You got my face on camera over there. I got my down the line camera over there, and you guys be quiet. Oh, that's pretty good. Thank you. What iron have we got?
Nine.
Perfect. And is there any one shot that you struggle with or anything that you do that you'd like to fix? Is it short game, putting, or you feel like?
Short game could be better.
Okay.
And I like to use my hands too much on the way through.
Okay. So short game could be better. I feel like maybe I use my hands too much on the way through. Still pretty good though, isn't it? Okay, so Jamie says first two pretty normal, left bias with hands.
Yeah.
Okay.
Left hole location, especially when adrenaline's running to a back left hole location, short sighting there.
Okay.
That would be
awesome. Yep. So, I mean, it's good, right? I mean, tempo is good. Most of us would look at this and go, I'd love to work with this student right here. This is pretty awesome. Really nice. You can see she's warming up now. Great strike. Really good. Okay, one more, and then I'm just going to ask her to do a couple things for me. I'm going to check a couple things. Okay. All right. Come on over here. Come on over here. Thank you so much for doing that. Give her a round of applause. That was awesome, right? Okay. So here's a couple of things. This is the way my mind works when I look at this, just to show you this is pure coaching, right? So I see someone that looks like she's in incredible shape, all right? But I want to test her because even though she looks like she's in great shape, doesn't mean she's in functional shape for her golf swing. There may be something there that isn't working. So a couple that I'm going to look at just based on what Jamie said is I'm looking at how is this club going this way, and there's a slight curve, there's a little bit of crossover of the club face through impact. So I'm just looking at a couple things in my mind. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm thinking about a test, something I can check with her body that might correlate to that. So the first one we're going to do is just internal and external hip rotation on both sides. So usually what I would do is if I take a 6-iron, and an 8-iron here, and I put the 6-iron. The lie angle of a 6-iron is about 60 degrees. 4-iron's about 62 degrees, but this is a little bit less. So I'm just going to make a line, the bottom of there to there, and I've got just a little place to test. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to have you come up here. You're going to stand on your left leg, and you're going to just put your weight on your toe, and then standing tall, I want to see with your foot flat on the ground how much you can rotate. So do that on your left leg, sorry, stand on your left leg. Toe like this, right next to it, good. And just turn as much as you can this way. Just let your hips go. So she's like hypermobile there, that's unbelievable, right? Okay, we're gonna flip this, we're gonna go the other side. So we're gonna go the other way. And you're gonna step on the other foot, right there, toe up, and I wanna see you move that way. Just do that again. Okay, so that is not restricted. It's kind of on the line. I'm looking down this line to see how much turn she has. And when she goes that way, she actually increases the arch in her back a little bit, right? Now, naturally, most women have a little bit of a different orientation of the pelvis than men. And they're going to set up in a little bit of what we call S posture. So they're going to have a little bit of sway back in their lower back. And Veronica does have that. So the next one I want to look at is just side on. Can you just do what we did earlier? Just arch your back and flatten your back for me. Let me see that. So I'm seeing she sets up with what I call a little bit of S already. I want to see, can she increase that? So increase it. She does. And can she get rid of it? That's pretty good, right? Did you see that little shake? That's that shake and bake. We call that perturbation. That's just her brain trying to figure out what to do, right? I would want to smoothen that up because that alone could be the reason that she does what she does. And I'll explain. Okay, awesome. So the only other one I want to see you do is I want to see your separation. So arms crossed like this, and then just separate your lower body from your upper body. Yep, just like that. Just rotate for me. Okay, that's good. And then facing the group, you did this earlier, awesome. Just do a squat for me. Go down as far as you can. That's unbelievable, right? So out of those screens, the only one, and she moves great. I mean, if any of you try those screens today, be careful, for one. Especially the squat. Most of us are like, oh my God, go down, right? So that was amazing. And when you see a squat like that, that's what we should be able to do. When we were kids, have you ever seen a little baby? They walk up to toys and they just go, boink. You know, and they get up. I was with John Rahm and his little baby the other day, and I was like, can I film his squat? Because it's perfect. You know? And the kid's going around doing this. So when I look at Veronica, I'm going, okay, the only thing I got out of those is there's this little perturbation with the pelvis. Now, when I look at her from down the line, she doesn't sit quite as deep into this heel as I would like her to do. If there was a line on her tailbone, she's got a little bit of S posture. Anytime the pelvis is down and you try and rotate it, it will pull you forward, right? So she sets up in a little bit of S posture. She rotates really well, but as she goes back, she increases the S a little bit. Remember, I checked her internal hip rotation. So that's going to pull her forward. So if we had a line on her tailbone, that would be early extension on the backswing. So most players sit deep. Their right butt cheek goes behind the line. They shift and their arms come down in front of them. They create space and then they push and clear out of the way and they have space. Veronica has a little bit of early extension on the backswing. I think it's because of this perturbation and this little bit of S posture. And then on the downswing, she starts to move, but because of that, it doesn't quite clear as well as it could because she's got to get out of that position. And the club is a little bit into out, and there's just a little bit of crossover. I mean, I'm being picky here. This is a really good player. I have to be picky. On an amateur, you'll see this like crazy, right? So here's what we're going to do. I'm going to have you hit a couple more, but this time what I want you to do is I want you to get in your setup position. I want you to arch your back as much as you can. Then I want you to flatten it as much as you can. I want you to arch it as much as you can, and then I want you to go right in between, as if you're locking your abs in, okay? So I'm just gonna play this little game. I'm gonna see, does she have the ability to move her pelvis in the way I want to in order to lock that in, right? So we're gonna set up. She's got a little bit of S. I'm gonna increase the S, so increase it. Get rid of it, like Urkel, tuck it underneath. Right, and now go right in, go back again to the S and go right in between, right there. That's more neutral, right? And now what I want to do is I just want her to go. I want to hit her a few shots. Damn. You mean this shit really works? We have not. I mean, we've never seen each other again. So here's the thing. That was awesome, by the way. That was really, really good. So here's the thing. The other thing she said is short game. My short game isn't quite. Could that affect her short game? Yes. Because the pelvis, you know, what helps me take this club around? So in short game, I'm not trying to fire my hips. It's not a power move. A lot of times we're trying to control the face, control the pace. But what can happen is if I'm like this, and I get to here, because I haven't loaded the ground, because I'm not trying to create speed, I'm stuck. And now all of a sudden the legs can buckle or I can have a lot of flip. And my low point changes. So my strike might not be as good, right? So something as little as that. I mean, sure, her physical is awesome, right? But there's this little tiny bit, okay? That was great. You could sit for a minute. Thank you so much. So that was awesome. Thank you. So this is, I know I'm hammering you on this on screening, but I've seen the results. I know what this can do. And it's not a matter of, oh, it's too hard to do. Were those tests hard to do? Do I need to be a medical expert or a fitness expert to do those tests? No. Anybody can do that, right? Things like a lat test. I just need a wall over there. Can you put your back flat against the wall? Can you raise your arms like this? And you'll get the guy that's like, yeah, but I want to swing like Dustin Johnson. And you're like, okay, let me get a ladder, right? Because they can't move. So people that can't get their arms up in the air, if you've had a shoulder limitation or an injury, you can't get your arms up in the air. How are you going to swing like Dustin Johnson? You're not. So we take you a different direction. So all it does is it gives me this blueprint. It shows me two things, right? It shows me, here's what you do. So we got two options. I can either teach around it, which by the way is what most of us do every day. That's why you're so good at what you do. Because you go, man, they can't do this. Hey, drop your foot back a little bit. Let's fan it open. You don't even know they got internal hip rotation problems. But you can see them stalling out and going this way. So you're like, damn, if I just open that foot up, that's a teach around. For somebody who's got a tight hip, fan the foot, right? There's lots of little teach arounds. There's lots of little things we've learned throughout the years. When I get a good player, a tour player, that doesn't pass the screen, that's like gold. Because then I'm like, okay, dude, how do you do this? Because you are messed up and you're winning lots of money, right? And that's what I do. I'm like, how do you do this? Those are the gold. Because the ideal would be to go, guess what? You failed 6 tests, but so did Adam Scott. And he failed the same 6 tests as you. So maybe that's how we should swing. Jim Furyk. There's no Jim Furyk school of golf. The guy's like the 5th time all leading money winner, right? And nobody's going, here, let me just take the club over here and hit it straight down the fairway all day long. We don't teach that because it doesn't look good. I've tested Jim Furyk, right? For what he does, he moves beautiful. His kinematic sequence is perfect. It just doesn't look like everybody else's, right? So the only thing I'm trying to impress upon you is it's so very important because a lot of us are assuming that people can do. And where the biggest problem is our juniors and our kids. They don't move. When a kid is in the middle of a growth spurt and you get these 14-year-olds come in and they play baseball or they're great athletes and they walk in and they're trim and they got 12 packs of something right here. And you put them there and you go, can you touch their toes? And they go, I've never been able to touch my toes. They're 14. You go, what is going on, right? The problem is this, is that when you're in the middle of a growth spurt, your body is growing at different rates. It's not their fault, it's life. So their left leg is growing at a faster pace than their right leg, right? Their right arm is growing faster than their left leg. And all of a sudden, how many of us have had that 10, 11, how many of us had this one? The parents show up and they've got this 10-year-old that's gonna be the next Tiger Woods, right? I got him right here. I want you to coach him. Come on over, I'll show you what I've already built. You get out there and the guy's there and the little kid's there and he gets in, he's got the glove and he tears it down. He just, whew, and he's got this perfect little golf swing. Look at it, nothing. It's better than Tiger, he's perfect, right? And you're going, wow, that's amazing. He's 10. 10. You know what happens when he's 16? That same kid shows up and he's growing like 8 feet, like 6 inches, right? And now he's this big. And he's like, I don't know what's going on. It's your fault. He's hitting it all over the place. Can't control it. It's you. I need a new coach. Off they go. That's because the parent doesn't understand. This is just part of life. As a great coach, you need to understand what's going on. I want the kid that's showing up and doing this. Yee-hee, woo-hoo, the ball's going everywhere and that swings like this. That's the one I want. I want the one that hits it so far into the trees, you can't stand it. Educate the parent, right? Because part of our problem as coaches, we're like, damn it, there's that parent again. I can't believe they're here, right? But what you gotta do is you gotta turn around and give them a job. Okay, I'm going to explain to you what we do here. Come on over here. This is all about athletic movement, fundamental movement skills. Most kids today don't have them. I hate to shock you, but they don't have them. They didn't do what we did. We didn't have video games. We didn't have an iPhone that I could just go like this and scroll. This is my workout today. My thumb's doing great. Look how muscles in it. It's so fast, right? My neck's like this. And now they're all walking around like this, and they've got terrible posture, and this weighs 30 pounds, and they wonder why their neck's bad, and their shoulders are like this. That's kids today. When we grew up, it was like, you better be home by 6 or I'm going to kick your butt, because that's dinner time. Now get the hell out. And you're climbing trees and running around and hoping you don't get hit by a car. I was in Africa. We got lions. We got snakes coming at you, right? Mom's like, you better be back by 6. And you know, there's no cell phone, you know? And you get back home and you do this stuff, but you learn primal movement patterns. You learn to crawl, you learn to walk, you learn to jump, you learn to climb, you learn to do all the things the kids today don't do. So as part of your junior development program, PJ's done a great job of this. They've got some experts that have built that pathway. You need to look at that if you're not doing it, because that is the core of what you do. You've got to be able to take your junior programs, make them fun, educate the parent, that's number one, bring them in, sit them down, go, hey, I got 30 of your kids in my program. Let me show you what we do and why we do what we do, more importantly. And you educate them. Now, here's what I need you to do for me, and they'll be in. But if you avoid them and tell them, you drop them off and I don't want to see you ever again, right? They're the ones paying the bill, remember? You got to take care of them. I'm a parent, a lot of you are parents. You're interested in what they're doing. So very important that you understand that skill set and you know how to do that. So kids today don't have primal movements. We need to bring those back. It needs to be part of a safe program, and you're the safe program because they're not getting it in school. So very, very important that you do that. And if we can do that, we can develop great players. Not that we can't now, but they're not great athletes anymore. I see it all the time. I see these kids coming in and I'm like, I'm shocked at how bad they're moving. And I have to go right back to the basics. That never happened before. We're in a world today of speed and power. It's not going away. We all want to hit it 30 yards further. We're getting more and more information on the body. The next big phase, to me, is understanding how to use the technology that you're buying. That's very important. And why you use it. At TPI, we have Kistler force plates. They are pressure, force, pressure plates. Some of you may have swing cap plates, some of you may not have plates, some of you may have a body track. You're all interested in this. Dr. Scott Lynn, awesome, phenomenal at what he does. There's other guys, Mike Duffy, that are scientists that understand what's going on down there, right? And they'll tell you all kinds of things. But if you're trying to use that technology and you don't know how the shoe affects how they push, or you don't know that the type of foot they have or their ankle mobility affects how they push, just telling them to push won't work. Telling them what direction to push won't work. It's a perfect example, John Rahm. John Rahm has a club foot. This has been documented. He won't mind me telling you. When I first met John Rahm 10 years ago, he came to TPI. I used to do some talks for the Spanish Golf Federation. I'd go over to Spain. And they said, we've got some of these kids in college that are part of the Spanish Golf Federation. Would it be possible once a course to send them to TPI and you take a look at them? I'm like, absolutely. This kid, Juan Rahm, shows up. He's out there hitting balls. And you're standing there and it's just like, phew, phew, phew. And I'm like, oh, that's a different sound. That's a different sound. And then you're looking at this thing going, well, that's weird. Look at that. And that's weird. And he's got a, what the heck is going on here? And you're like, John, can I screen you? Sure. Take him in the gym. Fails everything. Well, not everything. It's on camera. Because if he sees it, he'll be like, you're fine. No, he failed about 7 tests, right? 7 of our 16 tests that we do. And I look at him and I go, listen, there's going to be a lot of people that try and change your golf swing. If anybody tells you to change this, this, or this, you need to run in another direction. Because, John, this is who you are. And here's why. When you were a kid, you had a club foot, right? The foot was broken and set, and he has no ankle dorsiflexion. He cannot do this with his ankle. It is locked in place, right? His right foot is size 12. His left foot is size 13. His right leg is shorter than his left. Why do you think he's such a great driver of the golf ball? We built the machine. Now, don't go and hammer your kid's leg and stop it from moving. John Rahm, when he sets up, he doesn't even have to add side bend or tilt. He's already there. He's like, this is great. Just there it goes, right? And then he's got this. Flexion, okay? Can't do this. No extension. What do all your amateurs come in with? Open face, cup, scooping, chicken winging. John can't do that. John can do this really well. On this side, he can do this really well. Can't do this really well. So what is that? Can do this really well and this really well. Does that make a pretty damn good impact position? He's like a robot. He's like perfect. And he has this wide swing. And look at the size of him. He's 250 pounds. He's 6'3". He's like a linebacker. He's got legs on him. He's got a butt. He can deadlift a house. The guy's massive. So with that short swing, because of his weight, he can produce a tremendous amount of speed without a long swing, without taxing his body. If I took weight off him, what could happen? Everybody's like, he's getting a little heavy. I'm like, here's another steak. Go ahead. You know? I'm monitoring all of that. We're looking at all. That's what teams do. That's what you do. Now, if we take that to another level and we go, let's take a look at Will Zalatoris. Will Zalatoris. Here's a kid that's incredible, right? I think he weighs about one of John's legs, right? John's 250. I think Will might be like 100 or one. I mean, I've never seen a skinnier human being that hits it that far in my life, right? And I'm not his coach. But he went down with a major back injury at the worst possible time. The guy wins his first tournament. He's number two in the FedEx Cup, and he's out of the next two events. He goes from guaranteed $5 million, possibly $15 million, to 500 grand. That injury cost him $4.5 million. It's a lot of money. Did it need to happen? Would you have changed him? You don't know, right? So here's a kid that is all world. He's hitting it amazing. Everybody's focused on maybe his putting doesn't look as great, but he still can putt. Otherwise, he wouldn't be there, right? And you look at that kid and you see guys with huge rotations. They don't weigh anything. They got to get the power from somewhere. I got to push against the ground more than anybody else. Rory McIlroy, more force into the ground than anybody I've ever seen. Hits it miles. Weighs 150 pounds. He's got to push hard, right, to get that rotational speed to create the velocity. John doesn't have to push nearly that hard. He's 100 pounds more than those guys. I don't need that. So I look at Will Zalatoris. My biggest concern for him would be his movement pattern. Is it broken? And everybody would be like, well, side bend with rotation is terrible with your for your back. It is, but that's what the golf swing requires. Good players have side bend with rotation. That's what they do. Okay, now his looks excessive because he's got a wiry frame. So does Joaquim Niemann. His looks excessive. Mito Pierra, his looks excessive. Do we fix it? Do we change it? These guys are at the pinnacle. Or do we dig a little bit deeper? And do we find what is really going on? And can we, without hurting it, give them just enough information to keep them where they are or get them to a whole nother level? I believe we can. My biggest concern with Will Zalatoris would be thoracic spine mobility. If you watch him, it looks like he's got huge thoracic spine mobility. You look at his lower back, it's bent. You look at his setup, it's S posture. He sets up with S posture, he rotates like this, has got more S posture, and his back has this huge, that's what we call on 3D, that's reverse spine angle. It doesn't look like it, but once you go past 90 degrees, you're going past, right? It's not a matter of when, it's not a matter of if, it's when your lower back can come down at the force these guys are applying. So at the highest level, you have to be very careful. If you're ever dealing with these players, just because they're good doesn't mean that they'll stay there. Because he's in a position right now where he's one of the best players in the world, and he's scared because he doesn't know whether he's going to play golf again, right? Fortunately, I think he's got an amazing team around him. He's brought them together. And I think he's going to be fine. So that's a good thing. But that would be my concern. And every year I look at the injuries. Lanto Griffin has been out, herniated disc, set up like this his whole career. S posture, comes into impact, early extends a little bit, crossover. Jimmy Walker was a PGA champion. Jimmy Walker has Lyme disease. That's a big factor. That's inflammation in the body. Inflammation in the body is food. So if you really want to understand and you want to get your movement pattern better, then we better understand what you're eating every day. Because if you don't feel good when you wake up in the morning and you feel like you have brain fog, that's what you're putting in your engine. That's like taking a Formula One car and going, hey, let's just throw the 87 gas in there. That thing won't win. It needs high test fuel. You got to be careful of this. So when we talk about longevity, we talk about vitamins, we talk about all that type stuff. At the very highest level, we're looking at all of these pieces because it's what makes my car run the best every time, right? Okay, so injury-juicing mechanics. The big ones for me, S posture. That causes lower back pain. Early extension causes lower back pain. It creates right rotation. It throws your center back, causes lower back pain, right? Reverse spine angle causes lower back pain. Anything that causes lower back pain, I got to go after it right away because that will take somebody out of this game. And if you've had a back injury, you know, because when you try and get up and you feel that pain, that's not fun, right? And we can do better. We can do better by understanding how our players move. It's very simple. Now, I get the country club member that's 65 years old and comes in and fails every test and doesn't even want to do any test. Why are we doing this? I just want to hit a few balls further and I want to have my pizza at the turn and a beer, right? We get that guy every day. And here's how you handle it. This test isn't for you. It's for me so that I don't ever tell you to do something you can't do. You in? It shouldn't be an option. It shouldn't be, oh, you know, we do this lesson and then we have another price for the physical screen. That's like going to the doctor and you go to the doctor and he goes, well, guess what? I've got this big barrel of pills over here, right? You could just put your hand in and pick one, or you can come over here and I'll do a few tests and I'll tell you which one you should take. How many of you do that? Oh, great, what do you got in there? Right? You wouldn't do that, so don't do it. It's that easy. Movement is easy. It shouldn't be that hard, right? So I beat you to death on that. So injury-inducing mechanics, big part. So let's talk a little bit about technology and how we use it. And then I'll try and, I know I've got till, what time do I have till, 3:15? So technology, most of you guys have known me for a long time. I wrote the first swing analysis for golf back in, I was part of the problem. In 1989, I was at a country club. My first country club was in Echo Lake Country Club in Westfield, New Jersey. And I had a great golf pro by the name of Mike Preston. And Mike was an attention to detail nut. He went to the University of Alabama. And he was like, you don't do it again. Do it again. And he made me pay attention to detail. And he said to me, he introduced me to a member. And he said, you're really good at communicating and teaching. That's what you need to do. So go learn everything you can. He gave me a great opportunity to do that. And one of the members at my club was into computer science, and I was using, like everybody else, the old VHS camera. You know, we used to walk out. We'd film you at 30 frames per second. Wow, this is amazing. And we'd have the little jog shuttle on the VHS. Kip knows, he's done this before. And we get the dry erase marker out, and we line it on the screen. I'm like, get in there with the jog shuttle, and there you go. That's what you do, right? Well, I developed a computer that you could split the screen. I told you, I screwed everybody up. And I said, here's a good player, and here's you. You suck, and he's really good. So let's go out and make you like him. Totally wrong, right? But we've all done it for years. And now that technology's on your phone, right? So remember, not that I'm going after the guys that have video systems and so on, because in the right situation, they're awesome. Technology is a state today that it's never been before, and it's exciting what's going on. But always bring it into your realm and understand how to use it and what to do with it, right? So we talk about force and pressure. We look at TPI. The biggest way we use it, I do power testing. I look at when you are jumping, are you better jumping from your left leg or your right leg? Or both, right? So another easy way using like fitness equipment, we do a power test. We have a whole power class. We studied the World Long Drive guys. What do they do? How do they do it? We do a vertical jump. We look at how high you can jump. This is quite amazing. We talked about this yesterday with some guys that were down there with us. Vertical jump. So say on, this is the PGA Tour averages. So you do a vertical jump, 18 to 22 inches. That's PGA Tour average, 18 to 22. We take a medicine ball that's 4 kilograms, okay? And we do a sit up and throw. You lie on your back and you sit up and throw it. Now it's in feet. How many feet do you think is the PGA Tour average? 18 to 22 feet. Like, well, that's pretty cool. It's the same as the jump. And then we do a chest pass where you sit in a chair, back against a chair. We take the ball and we have you throw it as far as you can, right? What do you think the PGA Tour average is? 18 to 22, right? If you're within that realm, if you're 20-20-20, it shows us that your power is equal. And usually I can predict your ball speed within 1 or 2 miles an hour just by knowing those numbers. It's scary how accurate it is, right? Now, what happens when I get the guy in that's got this one? Is Phil around? No. Who's got like 2 or 4, right? Or let's give him the benefit of the doubt. Let's say he's got 8, right? Got 8 vertical jump, awesome. And there's never any bad, you're all, oh, that was great, great job. And then you do the sit up and throw and he's got 14. You're like, wow, that's pretty good, 14. And then he does the chest pass and he's got 12. Well, now I look at it and I go, got 8, 14, and 12. The dominant power source is his sit up and throw, it's his core, or it's his push pass. Once I find the dominant power source, it's amazing how scary that shows up in their golf swing. So over the toppers, the guys that have lost their glutes, tight hamstrings, have no core control, what do they use to hit the golf ball? That's what I got, baby. Chop that thing. Take that tree down. They still have this. They still have upper body strength. So they use their upper body strength in their swing. It's a great test that you can do. We do that all the time. I love finding out power sources. Because once I found your power source, then it's very easy for me to go, okay, if we can just bring the other pieces up, and this is the value of kinematic sequence in 3D. 3D, I don't care about numbers. I'm not in the slightest worried about how much rotation you have. The only thing I look at is graphs. The interaction between the lower body core, upper body club, the kinematic sequence. That's what I'm concerned about. I want to know when it's firing, what's firing, is this going way early and leaving this behind and then these have to catch up? Is this going way early and these are way late? What's the sequence? Because sequence is a huge power source, right? So if you're trying to optimize your power, you can swing clubs all you want, jump up and down all you want. But if your sequence is bad, that's a major power loss. So we look at 3D to look at what's off in the sequence. Do all tour players have great sequence? No. But they usually make up for it with something else. They have poor sequence, but their short game is incredible. Their mind is incredible. They don't have as much power as they could, but these other parts make up for it. So really all we're trying to do as coaches is everybody is like a jigsaw or a Rubik's Cube, and it's messed up. And I'm trying to go, okay, you're giving me this cube and the colors are over here and I got to put it back. What's the best way to do that? Should I turn it to the left or should I turn it to the right? That's what I'm thinking when somebody comes in. And to do that, I build a team around them. And we do that through TPI. That's what we've done for years now. And that's why we did our education platform, is because what I'm trying to do is educate medical professionals, physical therapists, chiropractors, massage therapists, biomechanists, whatever. I'm trying to connect fitness professionals and us golf professionals, who, by the way, you guys are the team leaders. I'm trying to put those three groups together. Because as a team, you can do so much more. And if you integrate that in what you do, your teaching program will go off the charts. Don't think they're taking away from you. If you've got fitness and medical as part of your team, how many of you are dealing with 55 to 70-year-old members every week? And if you just had a massage therapist that came in twice a week, they'd play better golf. Because you've increased their mobility. You've fixed that broken pattern. And that's what's so very, very important, right? Okay, I'm almost there. I appreciate you guys taking the time and sitting. I know this is tough when you've got this much going on, and it's amazing. So we're a little bit early, but I'm gonna open up for questions, because that's really the beauty of this, is seeing whether you guys have questions about what I'm saying, whether you agree with me, disagree, that's fine. Remember the judgmental thing before? Be curious, judgmental. Don't be too mean. So let's start with some questions. Anybody got any questions? Yeah. Okay.
Will Zalatoris. So going back to Will Zalatoris. So in my mind, the easiest fix at the top of the swing would be he's going to need to find a way to pelvic tilt, right? He's going to have to find a way to get the stomach muscles engaged on the way down. Mm-hmm. Is that correct, or would you go about it differently?
No, I would go about it differently. So Will Zalatoris, is this the tree of trust here? Okay. Will Zalatoris has poor thoracic rotation. He uses this for his golf swing really well. The problem is it's hurting his back, right? That's what I know, right? So I think that someone like him, who's incredible, and I mean, amazing talent, and I think he'll have no problem. I think this is fine. I would go after this. If I can get this moving, I can take the stress off this. Most people go down with lower back pain because the segment above and the segment below isn't working. So if my thoracic spine is tight, right, then what am I gonna do? I'm gonna let this go, use those muscles that should be stable, that area that should be stable, right, and I'm gonna make it mobile. Same thing with if the thoracic spine is good and the hips are tight. Hips are tight, what could I do? Well, I could use my knees and rotate this way, or I could use my lower back to turn. And we see that all the time. So I get where you're going there, but knowing a little bit about his movement pattern, I'd go after the other area. Yeah. Yes.
Oh, you can't do it in the same room.
You're great. I just had a quick question. When someone is getting turf toe or problems with the peroneal side of the right leg, mm-hmm. what is the cause of that?
So I would screen you first, if it is you. I'd have to look at the whole chain to find out why, right? I would definitely be interested in your foot pattern, whether it's orthotics or what you're wearing on your feet. And there's things that we call neural resets. Today, there's a lot of great technology that enables us to look at why the pattern is causing what it is, and we can reset it.
Snowboarding and knocked my hip out of place, and it was recently put back in place.
So there you go. So right now your hip's back in place, but you've got the scar tissue in your brain, right? So your brain is sitting there going, I don't want to go there yet. So we need to retrain you. If the pain is gone, I'd have to take you through a movement pattern to convince this that it's okay to do, right? So there's some incredible stuff out there. I'm actually in the middle of a study with, I was telling some people before, with 8 Navy SEALs. So these guys are out. Incredible what they've done in their lives, but they're broken. Most of them are really broken. And there's a group out of Israel that uses high-level hyperbaric to regrow stem cell in the brain. And we're looking at brain scans, and we're finding that whether you've had a concussion, most of us had when we were kids, we just didn't know, we fell and hit our head, and our dad's like, get out there, you'll be fine, right? Now we're like, oh my God, they hit a soccer ball and they've got a concussion, right? But they could. It could cause a concussion, right? Concussions create dark scar tissue in the brain. Signals are getting fired. There's way smarter people here than me that know this, that they fire signals from the brain. So whenever there's a blockage or something going on, the brain's pretty smart. It'll use something else. And that's kind of this thing, is like figuring out what it is that happened to you and then retraining the pattern so that your brain goes, you know, it's okay. This is what happens all the time. Someone comes in and they've got like no hip rotation, and you do a test on them and you're like, man, dude, you've got an impingement in your hip. You need a hip replacement, right? They go get a hip replacement. This happened. Perfect example, Peter Jacobson. Peter Jacobson comes to us many years ago and he's like, man, I got this terrible pain in my left hip. It's really hurting my ability to play. If you guys can just get me through the next 6 weeks, I'm gonna have a total hip replacement. Right? So we bring him in and we put him in our lab and we look at the kinematic sequence. And because of the pain, when he hits the pain, he stops, early extends, and flips. And Peter always had a good sequence. His sequence was starting to change. And right away we shut him down. Because we were like, Peter, you cannot go play the next 6 weeks. You have got to get that hip surgery right away. Because the kinematic sequence is now changing. Your brain is writing a new motor pattern. Brains don't like to get rid of old stuff. So just think of instruction. You're like, you're doing this. You're doing this. We're going to get rid of that. You need to teach them something totally new. They don't like to get rid of old stuff. So it's kind of like a path through the forest, right? and you got this neurons and you got the brain going through the you got the forest. Well, all of a sudden there's a tree fall down and it's in the way. And you're like, we need to go around it. Let's create another path. Now this path is really worn and this path isn't that worn. We need to keep going that path till it's worn more than this path and this one's overgrown. This one will never go away. That's why when most people get a lesson, right? I think Rick Jensen used to talk about this one. And Henry Brunton, great coaches, phenomenal people. I remember Rick saying to me once, he goes, if you came to me, and I'm stealing this from him, this is his. So he said, if you came to me and I was the best in the world running backward coach, right? And you go, I'm going to teach you how to run backwards. You're going to be awesome. And he said, you come to me and for a week, we do nothing but running backwards. We're running backwards. And you're like, damn, at first I wasn't good, but now I'm really good at running backwards. And you go out that weekend with your son in the woods and a bear runs out. Which way are you going to run? You ain't running backwards. You're going to turn around and run this way, aren't you? Because you haven't changed the motor pattern yet. You're going to go right back to what you do. And that's what everybody does every weekend. I had this great lesson. Dave was awesome. We hit balls. We did this. And then I went out and I hit it over there again. First tee, one ball, water right, trouble left, boom. I haven't done that. That's the next phase of our world. To me, I'm so excited about it. Guys like Rick know this. That's the next phase of the world for us. It's, can we retrain this better? Can our practice programs at facilities like this be so good that I can change that pattern and get somebody to go straight to the first tee and right away be able to perform? That's the gold. And if we can do that, we can help a lot of people love this game forever, right?
I had a question. You were talking about Jim Furyk earlier, about how his kinematic sequence is good.
Yeah.
But also, hasn't he had a lot of wrist problems? And do you think the way the club has been orbiting his body led to that?
It definitely could be. I mean, I've never been part of his team or not. I know he's had wrist issues. The fact that his arms dropped so deep behind him, right? But he got extremely clear, right? He had a lot of this down through impact. But his sequence was good. Now, I'm talking, 10 years ago when he was playing, he wasn't on the Champions Tour. His wrist injuries came later. But it could definitely be the cause of that, for sure.
And then, sorry, real quick question. You're talking about footwear.
Yeah.
What are your findings? What are your thoughts on maybe getting flatter, wider footwear?
So that's a great question. So we talk about footwear. In fact, the Quaid Shoe Company, I think, is here. And last year, John has that dorsiflexion problem with the ankle. And when he sets up to the driver, he's already this way a little bit. And I noticed it actually at Augusta, because there were a couple holes at Augusta that he doesn't like, right? One is the second shot on 8 uphill. So you've taken a guy that's got a platform like this, and now he's like this, trying to hit a 3-wood that's gonna draw, but it's taking him on the outside of the shoe, right? So the shoe was a soft shoe, very comfortable, but it wasn't supporting what he needed. And I'm looking at that, I can see his foot going on the outside of the footbed. So I brought him in, and I said, right, we're gonna figure this out. So the first thing I need you to do, I need you to get on force and pressure barefoot. I want you to hit balls barefoot for me. So he gets on there, barefoot, 189 mile an hour ball speed, fastest. Push, better, should be, right? There's nothing interacting with the shoe, and it's the foot. I'm getting maximum force into the ground. But a lot of people, if their foot or their toes or their ankles, it could cause some stress. And it caused some stress with no shoe because of the ankle problem. But the fastest speed. So then I said to him, I go, if there was one shoe that you love to practice in, what is it? He goes, my Kobe 8s. I'm like, really? I go, where's the Kobe 8s? He goes, I got them in the car. Go get the Kobe 8s. We go get the Kobe 8s. We bring them out, puts them on, stable, great pressure, 184 speed. I put the Quaid, the soft one on. 179, 180, right? I haven't done anything but change the shoe. We got the guys from Quaid down. We did some force and pressure twisting. They did some stuff with the shoe he's wearing now just so it could hold his orthotic better. And his speed this year has been up 4 miles an hour. Now, a lot of that's because of Spencer Tatum. His trainer's done an amazing job at him moving better. But a piece of that is the stability in the foot. All of us have probably played golf with a pair of shoes that were like, that's my gamers right there. Those are the ones with the toe, and that's the one I play in. But when I go to practice, I just put my sneakers on. Yeah, I put those soft things on. Why? Why would you do that? Why would you practice in something you don't play in? It makes no sense, right? You wouldn't go play soccer without your spikes on, right? But we go play golf all the time and we're like, yeah, I got my Kobe, I got these on, they're great, yeah. No, they're not. You're changing your pattern. So again, back to, there is a shoe that's right for all of you, but I don't know what it is. It's kind of like my philosophy on golf, right? I don't believe there's one swing. I believe there's thousands of swings, but I do believe there's a swing for each of you, but it's based on what you can physically do. So I need to test you first. Yeah. So the question is do I find any difference between a player's ability to rotate into the trail hip and the lead hip? The answer is no. Everybody's different, right? Everybody has different physical ability. That's why I need to test them. You know, if you don't test, you're just guessing as far as I'm concerned. So to me, I'm big into looking at that. I mean, the hips, the functioning. You know, power comes from the ground. We know that. We know the way you push, force precedes motion. This is why you see these guys moving and loading and stuff like that. That's great new stuff we're learning, right? And now it's a matter of tracing that up the chain. So this is why we look at the chain. So you got the legs and then this area. This is like the power plug, right? So I got two extension cords, one here and one here. At address, if I'm in S posture, they're unplugged. If I'm in S posture, they're unplugged, right? If I lock them in, they're now plugged. Now, as I go back, they're gonna try and come apart because we all extend. A lot of us sometimes now extend even more because we're trying to get more speed, right? So again, you gotta know what you're working on because there are a lot of great teachers that are like, hey, I want you to get up there so that you can get down and push against the ground. That could be great for you, but it might be horrible for you. Because I've seen guys that go, no, you need to sit there so that you can push against the ground. Then that's all understanding how they do what they do, right?
Cool, yes. We're gonna do one more question and then we got 2 minutes on something else. So you're the last one, what do you got?
Do you see many left thumb injuries? And if so, what causes that?
So left thumb, thumbs and wrists scare me, right? Thumbs are, I mean, these are little tiny joints and you're going, I mean, this can really screw somebody's game up, a thumb injury or a wrist injury, right? So when I see those, because back in the day when Bob Toski said to me, he goes, you take care of your shoes because they're the only thing connected to the ground and you take care of those hands because they're the only thing connected to the club, right? So thumbs, you've heard about short thumb, long thumb, right? A lot of it can be arthritis in the joint. It can be the way you load the club, so it could be wrist. But again, if I'm getting pain in the thumb, I'm gonna look above it to the wrist, and then I'm gonna look to the elbow. And I'm just gonna see if there's a breakdown there that's causing more pressure in the thumb. That's where I would go first, right? And there are a lot of manual therapists that are amazing. They got golden hands. They can go, well, it looks like you need this, and you go, ah, right? And they just put one hand on you, right? Those are the people you need to find. They're amazing.
Cool. So we're going to do this. We didn't rehearse this, but I think he knows where we're going. He's part of our medical team. He calls me his mentor, but I'm not really his mentor.
There
which is
are. Come on.
Yeah. Yes, we watch golf together. Last year, John and Patrick played 24 times together.
They did.
And they played for 2 weeks together. And so we spent a lot of time. But when Patrick was hurt, we went to TPI, and we had gone to TPI, and we had been buddies for a long, long time. And he... what he did exactly today is he simplified really difficult things that had taken, you know, way longer than both of us combined have been professionals to figure out. And the way he does it in simple terms, that's how we work with. So we already built a circle of trust amongst us. Mm-hmm. So they had a bunch of numbers that weren't going to work for Patrick and I. But basically what happened, contrary to popular belief, is Patrick did not have a broken back and he didn't have back surgery. He had a stress fracture in his back that looked like a little tiny piece of dental floss in the x-ray, which I never saw, even though I looked at the x-ray about 100 times because it was really tiny. Yep. And one of the things that we found out is everybody's got stress fractures every place, just whether you have them in your shins, you have them in your elbows, you have them in your back, everybody's have them. So whether it was going to bother you or not, but with Patrick, it was super, super painful to the fact that I saw him go down a couple times because the pain was so much, and Patrick's a tough kid. Like, for example, this year, Patrick played the last round of the Los Angeles Open with food poisoning and throwing up the whole night and then just walked out on the first tee and smashed it, you know? So he can suck it up and play the way that he's supposed to. He asked me three things, and like I said, we didn't rehearse this. When I first met him, he said, "What can you tell me about Patrick?" And I said, "X Factor, whatever that means." And he goes, "Hmm, you never said that before, but that's cool." And then he said, "Secondly, what do you notice about his body?" And I said, "Well, his arms are like he's 6'4", and his hips are like the fastest moving hips ever, but we hadn't tested and we hadn't done a screen. And I've never seen him run, and I don't know if he can catch or throw. And he's really, really, really smart." So that was kind of about his body. So sure enough, after the stress fracture, we went to like 40 different doctors. And every doctor was the same thing, kind of their glasses down like that, looked at the screen, you know, looked at him and said, "Well, I can fix you in a couple of weeks. You know, we're going to cauterize your nerve, or we're going to do an operation on your back, or we're going to do this or that." And Patrick and I walked out of every office and went, shh. And the original doctor that he saw, Dr. Watkins, said rest. And he told me to rest. And so then after he rested, he said, "Well, what are you going to do to his swing?" And I said, "Well, you know, when he got back to the U.S. Amateur when he was 15 years old, he said, I got to hit it a lot farther." So we worked on hitting a sling draw, and he could hit 30 or 40 yards farther with the sling draw, and he became Patrick Cantlay world number one. And then turned pro, and then trying to hit it that far with putting any type of pressure on that spine was hurting, but it wasn't even noticeable the way that we actually looked at it. So then after all that, he said, "Well, what are you going to do?" And I said, "Well, I know that his spine compresses a little bit of impact, so we're just going to get pressure off of that." And he wanted to have perfect Adam Scott posture, but his body couldn't make perfect Adam Scott posture, so he needs to just hang over the ball. And he said, "Yeah, that's exactly right." Well, that might be pretty simple, and I'm doing all the talking here, but that's all he said. And those were the magic keys to Patrick. So I thought it was pretty ironic last year when they finished the FedEx and John, you know, Patrick smashed his drive on the last hole, and John smashed his drive, and John almost hole his shot, and then Patrick hit in there, and John thought John was going to chip in, he just missed, and Patrick picked it up like that. And first guy to text me and to reach out was him and said, "Thanks a lot, and I've never got to thank you publicly. Thank you."
I appreciate that, man. I appreciate it. Thank you. Thanks.
Cool.
Awesome.
And then one more thing about this place, and I know Shar's going to close up, Dave. This is our what we call our shag range. Veronica built the gym. I think I told you this morning, the original Iron Byron used to be in that building right there. The gym, this is basically our stable area, our tour player areas. We hit shag balls out here. It's a lot more scientific than you look, but the greens are about a third of the size. So if you can hit it on one of those greens, you're pretty good. And the stumps are 20 yards apart. There's another bunch of stumps over there on that other range that we'll talk about later, but we like aiming on the stumps and kind of hitting it there and hitting it to spots. There's always one or two tour players here. A typical pattern for them is, like we said, play like a champion today. We don't give golf lessons here. They come and do warm-ups. Their warm-up is a procedure for them to get ready to go play, or when they're done, they do warm-downs. And the players that spend too much time out here just hitting balls don't become the best players that we've had, and we can say that from experience. And normally the warm-ups are 45 minutes or an hour, and then I'm watching golf every single day, but this is kind of where it all happens, so it's a cool spot. Normally there's tunes on in there. There's a workout going. V's normally training somebody and working out. Somebody's hitting balls here. And then there's something I like about hitting the shag ball and having to go pick your shag ball up by yourself. And if we're late for the tee, then I'll tip somebody to pick them up. I got to be honest, I haven't picked up a lot of shag balls. So that's that. It's a cool place. It's in really beautiful shape. And this one, every time that I'm out here, you know, I think not only do we love our job, that we're in love with our job. And every time that somebody wins a tournament, I either laugh or cry. And the laughing and crying comes from the quest that starts right here.
Thank you. Thanks so much for Jamie. He's amazing. Amazing. Hey, you're very welcome. You're very welcome. Thanks, guys.
That was a treat. Thank you so very much. I don't know if you'll find two people that love golf any more than the two gentlemen that were just standing in front of you. It's very special. So thank you both for sharing that with us and all of your expertise. So we'll head over just right behind you, or over to the right this way, to the field. And we'll be hitting some golf balls over there and hearing from Mr. Jonah Oliver.